So for starters, this episode is brought to you by SMP Inc., a Las Vegas business right here in Las Vegas. And they rebuild your confidence, and I'm hoping that they're going to rebuild mine here real soon. But this is a Hero's Journey podcast, and I don't even know what to think today because I'm really excited. I'm actually here with family. There are friends that come into your life that you choose that end up being family, and they have so much to do with my career before I ever met them to the day that as an artist, I became an artist and I got surrounded by their talent and they got involved with me. It's insane. So, but this podcast is actually about finding that inner drive. You know, you're the hero of your own story. So it's that wonder of crossing that line and creating your own circle that you are unique in this ordinary world, and you're special, and you can do special things. And my guests today inspire me every day. I say this, and I say it every time I'm on the phone with anyone. These guys have more talent in their little finger than most do in their whole body. So my friends and my guests today are Matt Nelson and Gunnar Nelson from Nelson. I'm really excited, guys, to have you. This is insane. Like we're sitting here with mics. I'm usually talking to you in a living room, or I'm talking to you in the car. We were just in the car listening to your new music.
Right.
You know, so here I am sitting with my friends.
Yeah, first of all, it's great to be here. And I'm very proud of you. This is
Thanks, man.
Perfect for you to be doing something like this. You're an amazing singer, great entertainer. But you're also, you're wonderful. Just when we were just sitting around chatting for years, it always goes to a really cool place. I think this is the spot for you. I like it.
Thank you.
Yeah, don't quit this. Hi, what's your name?
Gern Blanston.
Gern Blanston, nice to meet you.
Oh, no.
It's a pleasure.
Yep.
So Gunnar and I, we affectionately call ourselves the two-headed parrot. So you are in for it on this episode.
I know. Before we started, it was insane because the stuff that was going on.
Movie quotes.
Cracking me up. But you actually inspired me like right before we even got started on this whole thing. The look in your eye, you were so serious. We were talking about how I got a tap on the shoulder and how I ended up in this beautiful space here at Sticky Paw Studios in Las Vegas.
Right.
And you never know. You know what? I'm going to talk to you out there as an audience. If you don't know who these guys are, this is Nelson, the brothers Nelson. You guys have, how many number ones?
Well, we have one number one on the Billboard Hot 100 chart, four top 20 hits, top five Christmas. Sorry, five.
Five, yeah.
Wow. Who's counting? and this is kind of a cool time, too, because they just, on Universal Records, released a greatest hits compilation for us. We've had, 17 albums we put out.
Wow.
And finally got to do something that was spanning 30 years, which was kind of nice, on kind of like the beginning to the end of the whole Nelson journey, which is melodic hard rock type of thing. Gunnar and I are doing something brand new, which is called Firstborn Sons, which is a country rock effort.
Which I loved. I was listening to it in the car. Thanks. It was awesome. That thing's a monster.
Oh, thanks, man.
Yeah.
Thanks. It's cool. It's taking everything that we've learned from doing the arena rock thing with Nelson. And then we do a show in honor of our father, Ricky Nelson, called Ricky Nelson Remembered, which is more of like a country rockabilly thing. It's kind of a collision of the two, which is really what our dad did with his Stone Canyon band. But it's kind of drawing from 30 years of experience into what we love to play.
Yeah, we always envisioned it kind of being something when we play live, because it's a high-energy show, to kind of combine the two things. We thought about all the people like us that grew up with what is now considered classic rock, you know, from Def Leppard and all that
right.
kind of stuff. And
what'd you call it? It's Def Leppard meets...
Oh, no, that was just that one song.
Oh.
I said, that's what happens when Rascal Flatts meets Huey Lewis and the News and the Cult.
Correct.
Yeah,
exactly.
Pretty much.
So, yeah.
Totally schizophrenic.
That's right.
It's awesome. Sorry to cut you off.
No, that's true.
But
thanks for the big intro. But what we were talking about when we walked in here, I've had the benefit of watching you, Bryan, from a distance. You know, you've clearly spent more time with Matt. And Matt's closer to your compadre, Ben Carey,
right.
and stuff. I've always been stuck in a studio someplace while you guys were off doing whatever. And I have had the benefit of kind of watching you operate from a distance. The thing that I can observe is, like, the first time I met you, I did not expect somebody with such a big heart. You know, you've got this.
Thank you.
No, it's okay. But it's like I saw your promo photo back there, and it's like, you know, you guys owe me money. I mean, it's very tough, right? and then, you know, you talk, and you've got this big, giant heart, which is really great. And I love it when good things happen to good people. But what I wanted to bring up to you with this new opportunity you've got with the podcast is, like, I've never seen anybody work harder, which I really respect.
Thank you.
I mean, I respect tenacity. And in this business, you never know where your next opportunity is going to come from.
Oh.
And you know, you kind of like jump on it when you can. But I wanted to bring up to you, I mean, you're doing this podcast and it's taking off, which is a wonderful thing. But you work so hard being a singer, and you still do.
Right.
But I mentioned to you that our grandfather, Ozzie Nelson, of Ozzie and Harriet fame.
Huge.
Yeah, huge. Well, I mean, the family's in the Smithsonian, you know?
Right.
I mean, it's the longest running television sitcom in history at 14 and a half years and 435 episodes. But Grandpa Ozzie started out as a big band leader. He was a big band star. He had a number one in 1935 with a song called And Then Some. And he met our grandmother, Harriet. He wanted to hire a female, you know, chanteuse. So
right.
They came in. And apparently their connection and their banter between songs were really great and really natural. And it kind of evolved into kind of like a comedy bit over time.
Wow.
And then they were doing one of their, you know, hundreds of shows they did every year. And Red Skelton, who was the biggest radio star at the time,
huge,
caught their show and met them after the show and said, hey, you know, I think you'd be really great on my radio show. You want to guest on my radio show, which was the biggest show at the time.
Right.
And they did. And the response was amazing from the audience. And the network offered them their own radio show. And then that turned into an offer for a television show, which turned into that stat, which I told you. But I wanted to point out to you, like, Grandpa Ozzie, I read his biography. He always wanted to do music. He thought that that was what he was born to do, to the exclusion of everything else. And something that turned out to be kind of like a lark or a goof really kind of led to what really God intended for him
right.
all along.
Right. Right.
In his mind, he thought, I'm going to do this one thing. And then this other thing, it kind of led like a stepping stone to what he was really meant to do. And I just wanted to point out to you, like, you know, you never know. This actually might be what you were really meant to do all along.
It was just a long way to get there.
Right.
You know, I mean, Ozzie actually thought that television, when it stumbled into his life, was a fad and it was going to go away. And of course, the television show blew up. It was the most popular TV show ever, pretty much. And the longer the show ran, he thought, oh, it's going to get canceled. And and then he kept being renewed. And
yeah, I'm going to get back out on the road with my band. And it just, much to his chagrin, really never happened.
Wow.
And it wasn't until our father, Ricky, started singing that he could kind of live vicariously through him as a producer, so to speak, when there wasn't really such
right.
a thing. But he got to be around music and see our dad's meteoric success. But he never really got back on the road.
It's funny. We were talking with our grandmother, Harriet, before she passed. And you know, she was the first female singer in a big band situation. She was a big deal in her own right, a bigger deal actually than Grandpa Ozzie was. She
wow.
was making movies with like Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers and things like that,
wow.
you know. And she always thought that music was the through line of the family, which is ironic. The Nelsons are pretty much the most iconic television family ever. And she always thought that music was the through line. We loved to talk to her about music and stuff. We knew our grandfather Ozzie, but knew Harriet. She was around a lot longer. And I guess that's what it is sometimes, as Gunnar said, God has a different plan, and it just tends to be the one for you. So,
right.
So, you know, as we, you know, life happens when we're sitting around waiting for stuff to be successful, but you're doing a great job.
Thank you.
And, you know, people out there don't know this, but we were roommates.
Oh,
you know,
yeah.
We've, you know, you pretty much introduced me to my wife.
And, she's like a sister to me.
And but before that, yeah. I mean, I'm talking years before that, you came to one of our shows. In San Luis Obispo. You broke into our show.
I jumped the fence to see you guys play. I'm in San Luis Obispo. You're playing a fair, which on the ride over here I found out was like a rare thing for you guys to do. You didn't really do fairs. You were playing arenas and
it was 1991, I think, at the end of our After the Rain tour. We were out for 13 months, and I think in the last month is when we played a few of the big fairs. I think that was what, like 8,000 people were there. It
yeah.
was a big
it
thing.
It was huge.
It was a big thing.
I knew you were playing there. My cousin's back line to his backyard was the fair, and you were about to start. Everybody's running that way, so we jumped the fence and ran and watched you play.
A big diversion.
But I'm going to go back. I was a waiter in L.A.,
yeah.
So I was at this Italian restaurant, and all the girls start going nuts.
Oh, like the servers?
Yeah, that were working there. And the Nelson brothers just sat down on table, whatever. And I'm like, all right, that's my table. And then your sister walks in and she joins you guys for lunch.
Right.
And they're all like, I'll give you this and I'll give you that if I can wait on the table. And I'm like, no. And so I ended up waiting on you guys.
That's funny.
So those were my two encounters with you. And I had mentioned that I was even in Nashville and there was a race, the Mark Culley Foundation.
Yeah, it was for childhood diabetes, mm-hmm. right?
Right.
Yeah. But and pretty much everybody in Nashville was in that race. It was
everyone.
Brooks and Dunn, Mark Culley, Faith Hill, Tim McGraw.
Alan Jackson, who I became friends with
right.
that day.
Yeah, that was... That was a fun night. They did, I guess, a concert the night before to raise money, and then there was a big race at Nashville Speedway in Legends cars, which they race here in Vegas, too, at the Bullring.
Wow.
And a lot of fun. Everybody used to do that for a while. Everybody kind of had a car. We just borrowed cars. You know, we just showed up and raced, you know. Gunnar and I are... If it wasn't music, it would probably be motorsports, you know? We love that
you guys,
stuff.
Yeah, you guys are all about cars and bikes and things, and that was crazy. But I have a picture. It's somewhere, stashed somewhere. And I was trying to take a picture of you when you came up on the stage, and it's this guy's bald head.
Oh,
because it just flash of his head and a silhouette of you in the
I
background.
I love that. It's the irony of the fact that Gunnar and I got so much crap for having the long hair, you know, hair you could sit on.
Right.
And you have one picture of us with a guy's bald head.
Bald head. Right. And yeah, exactly.
That particular race, Matthew won that race.
Yeah.
I actually DQ'd. I actually passed Faith Hill on the infield.
She was a back marker. And Gunnar's like, dude.
I was getting frustrated.
Gunnar was good. He was doing, I remember, was it Parnelli Jones in a race that we raced once? He looked at you in the rearview mirror and he pointed at your mirror and said, get over.
Yeah.
You did the same thing to Faith Hill?
I did. It was okay. It was... I either crash or I win. But Matthew won, and because we were the kids from L.A. at
if
a national...
If you first, you're last. Right.
Right. Because he won, and we were from L.A., and we were in borrowed cars. Now, the Brooks and Dunn guys, they had something called the Metal Rodeo. That was their thing. And they toured when they went on tour with a big giant semi with their Legends cars in it.
Oh, it was genius. Oh. They could write off their racing effort as a promotional thing. It was genius.
Yeah, it was a great scam that they had going. And they hired a bunch of NASCAR crew chiefs. Like I mean, the series, all the cars are equal.
They're equal. We're gonna put quotes around.
Some are more equal than others. Okay, and these guys were geniuses at making these cars like extra special.
They could cheat. They would put stuff on the tires that made them a little stickier. You know, the motors look like they're sealed, but they've been gone through and then resealed. You know that kind of stuff.
That kind of stuff. And you know, Matt and I got into these borrowed cars and stuff. And Matt had like five or six car lengths on the Brooks and Dunn's guys. So of course his car gets teched at the end. They couldn't find anything wrong with his car. His car was illegal.
They were pulling the stickers off it. It came right out of the truck. Nothing was touched on it.
Now dig this. Let me finish, two-headed parrot. And then he got the trophy and did the whole podium thing.
Right.
And then as soon as the lights got shut down, which was instant because they made it very short because a non-Nashville guy won,
right.
They took his trophy away.
What?
They took his trophy away for 6 weeks, and there were some people who were racing in that race that protested his win.
They said there's no way he could win the race. The car's illegal. It's got to be, so they tore my car down. They tore the motor down. They do it at racing sometimes. You know, you get sore losers. But,
yeah. You know, but, you know, of course, I get a knock on the door at the place we were staying in West Nashville about 6 weeks later, and there's some courier there with Matt's trophy. Oh, here's your trophy.
Kind of oh, my God. No,
that's the kind of
I was there, though. That's there. What's cool, you know?
Yeah, that was fun. And it was, I wish they did
long
that.
Long before I knew you.
That's true. And here we are, all these, you know, you're the waiter aside and all that kind of stuff. Years later, I kind of became a silent member of Elvis Monroe. I actually came up with a name.
For that, though, you sang on my stuff, Paperback Hero.
Paperback Hero. Well, first of all, I'm still a fan of Paperback Hero. You know
thank
that.
Thank you.
That's one of the, you know, as musicians, we all have these things where we go, well, that should have happened. You know what I mean? And there are a lot of those. And it just is what it is. Paperback Hero was one of them. And there were a couple of real ringers on that. But
thanks,
I remember, and again, completely different style than what it morphed into.
Right.
But just as far as a melodic hard rock thing, I loved it. And I thought it was it turned out great.
But you were a part of that. And the reason it kind of landed, you guys sang on, like, was it Steel Panther stuff? And
well, it was
he did.
Oh, okay, yeah.
I remember calling Gunnar going, I got to read you these lyrics.
No. Now, at the time, in fairness, I was out in Nashville. I've been there for 27 years. So Matt was living in L.A.
Right.
The entire time. So
and I was really looking for something to do, to be honest with you.
Yeah.
And it was a little easier when you were my roommate to, hey.
what happened was Ben Carey called me and introduced me to a producer, Jay Rustin.
Amazing.
And yeah, great guy. And he's really blown up now as a producer and stuff. And he was looking for kind of like a lot of producers, like Gunnar has the same thing. It's like you have your team of people that you know that if you call them, you can just nail it, just get it done quickly and move forward. So for a while there, I kind of became Jay's go-to guy for vocals. And I think I sang on albums from the Donnas, who is producing, something called Army of Freshmen, was a, you know, kind of alternative rock band.
Right.
And of course, Paperback Hero.
Right.
And Ben told me a lot about it. I think that's really where we met, and we're hanging out and
right.
stuff like that. And I eventually became your roommate. I had a life change, you know, like a marriage ended and stuff. And actually, Ben and you introduced me to my wife, Carrie, my wife now. And we were roommates. You know, I was just kind of a man without a country in yep. L.A., you know, I'm paying for one house and a whole
a big house in Hollywood Hills.
Yeah, and I'm like, I'm homeless. You know, it was like one of those things. But it was a very transitional point in my life where I really needed good friends, and you were there for me. So I've never forgotten that.
Thank you.
And it's important to have that. Again, you know, I think God provides. So it was just one of those moments in my life. I mean, I remember once, you know, ironic to say this, but, you know, we're always reminded of where we've come from, that we're all the same and all that kind of stuff. It got to a point where, you know, it got very lean for me, you know, between, you know, paying for stuff and lawyers and all that. And I remember kind of, you gave me kind of a roof over my head. And it was like when I got a phone call, like there was once I got a phone call that some kind of money fell from heaven. And I literally cried because I had no idea how I was going to eat, you know?
Right.
Meanwhile, I'm paying for some ridiculous lifestyle for somebody else that I'm trying to extricate myself from. So it was a good message. That
it was worth it.
It was definitely worth it.
It was worth it. Now you have little Ozzy.
But you need your friends. Yeah, and now I have a little boy who's just about 8 years old. Life moves on, and that's really what I wanted to be. I wanted to be a dad and have work with family and have people in my life that, as Gunnar said, you know, they're the good people that come in. You're one of them.
Thank you.
I'm proud of you.
Appreciate
love
that,
you, brother.
Man. I love you too. Yeah. Thank you, guys.
Do you want me to leave the room?
No.
I knew that was going to come out.
I knew.
I gave you guys some private time.
Hey, take a nice drink of vinegar. Here you go.
That's crazy. You know, I fell down the rabbit
hole.
Good
twin, evil twin.
Right? I've known you guys for so long that I knew you back then. Like, you guys have a new Greatest Hits album. It's Greatest Hits and
Near Misses.
And I downloaded it. I've been listening to it. I was listening to it at the gym. I'm like, this is taking me back to, you know, the day when you guys were playing arenas. And Trav, the chief nerd back there, Travis today, I fell down a rabbit hole of videos on YouTube in the last couple of days. Just like, wow, this is Gunnar and Matt. But wow, this is amazing. I never really dove into that. Show them like the Arena Rock one. I want the fans out there who are watching this to see some of this. This was the More Than Ever, I think it was.
Yep.
Nelson video was it was a live video.
Yeah, at the Olympic Auditorium in Los Angeles, old place. Actually, Grandpa Oz used to watch boxing matches there.
Yeah,
and it was interesting. Our first video was almost like Technicolor and really kind of more of an art project, Love and Affection.
Mm-hmm.
The second second video, we had a little bit of a performance thing. We filmed that at the old LA Zoo had been decommissioned. But we really needed to do a live video. And the audio on the More Than Ever video was live. And nobody knew it. But we brought in a mobile truck. So that's us playing
The problem is we wasted about $500,000 recording that and making live audio. But it sounded, our band was so good at the time. We always say we hired a bunch of guys who were way overqualified to play the pop music that Matt and I wrote. But we had the greatest band at the time.
Bobby Rock on drums,
Paul Merkovich on keys, Brett Garsett on guitar. I mean, these guys are amazing.
Joey Cathcart on rhythm and vocals. So everybody sang except for Bobby.
No, yo, homie.
Yeah, but there was no tape. There was no backing tracks. There was none of that stuff, which is what people do nowadays.
Right.
It was dead ass live. And the problem was it sounded so much like the record. We wasted the money even recording it that way because no one knew.
Right.
No one knew that it was live.
But it was fun because we just did a little thing. We put it out. Hey, Nelson is going to be doing a live video. And what you're going to see is that everybody just showed up.
You know? I just want a little bit of that. Like, give me 30 seconds if you got it up there.
Yeah,
Wow.
Fun times, man. That was
wow.
cool.
Wow.
Gunnar's hair still looks the same.
At my age, I'm just happy to have hair.
That's right. I took mine off for my brother, and I noticed that I was balding back here and had... It was just going back that way. This is not cool.
Hey, man, as we go forward in life, we tell a story physically.
Yeah.
It's okay. Chicks dig scars. You know?
Want to slide into home plate battered and bruised.
Exactly. That was awesome.
Thanks, man. It was really living the dream. Honestly, that was one of those things where we, like you, always had to work against the current. We always had to fight uphill. We have a unique karma is in that everybody sees us coming from the very beginning and they assume trust fund. It's a hobby. Things were easy. Doors were open for them because of the familiar connections, all of that. Nothing could have been further from the truth. And we always looked at it this way. We come from a long line of professionals. It was no one's business to know the struggle. Our job was to present them something like that, which was an alternate universe that they could escape into.
That's what music's about.
That it is.
Sure.
That's it. So, you know, midwifing that whole thing through all of that, what I'm most proud of, honestly, is what people used to slag us for, the fact that they didn't know the truth was a great compliment because we never said, oh my God, it was so tough and it was so hard. We just wanted to bring the rock. That's what we wanted to do.
You know, I was watching interviews and I know you guys, but to watch some of the interviews where you're saying, my dad was my best friend. You know, you're like, mm-hmm. each of you say it constantly. And living up in that, the ghost house and the things that you guys went through.
Yeah.
You guys had this, your grandparents were Ozzy and Harriet. I mean, the camera work that's done, they use to this day, and it was done on that show. I Love Lucy wouldn't exist if it wasn't for the Ozzy and Harriet show.
True that.
You know, and then your father being who he was, this icon, this place is full of Elvis stuff. And you guys have told me stories about pickup games with Elvis Presley and your dad and, you know, really cool things like that. But then to move into you're getting hit with, you're these Hollywood kids and people just thinking, oh, you're getting this opportunity.
I don't really blame them for thinking that way because in all honesty, our record company, Geffen, back at the time, which was the really prestigious label to come out on, it was an easy sell for them because, for the record, Matthew and I never did a single interview for a single teen magazine, ever. We wanted to do more credible magazines and stuff, but that's an easy sell for the label. You know, we took some pictures and they went to the photographers and the photographers sold them to the teen magazines, made a ton of money. We saw none of it. But the next thing you know, that's all over the place. But for some reason, they could have helped us out quite a bit if they had just said, they wrote all the songs, they produced all the music, they put the look together, they put the band together, they did this. It was easier for them to go, oh yeah, well, who cares if they think it's a fabrication of some Svengali label or something. And it wasn't, you know, back in that time, you got to think, our competition, especially at Geffen, it was a genius thing that David Geffen did. He had three different A&R guys under the same roof. They all had long-term contracts. They weren't going anywhere. But they were very different sensibilities.
They all hated each other, by the way.
They did, yeah. and he fostered that competition thing amongst the different stables of artists that each A&R guy had. We were with John Kolodner, the guy who turns around and the dude looks like a lady video in the wedding dress. That's a real guy. That was our guy. He had Whitesnake during their big album. Actually, through all their years.
Yeah, he put Aerosmith back together. He originally signed AC/DC when he was working in another label. I mean,
he signed
a legend.
He signed Foreigner when he was, you know, at ATCO. The whole thing. I mean, the guy was a genius.
Right.
Then you had Tom Zutaut. Tom Zutaut was Mr. Guns N' Roses,
mm-hmm.
right?
And then you had Gary Gersh.
And then you had Gary Gersh, who had who was that that girl who had that famous meeting at Marco Babineau's office where she showed her displeasure by urinating.
Inger Laurie,
yeah.
So they're all but the bottom line was they all had different corners of this building on Sunset Boulevard, all hated each other and were enticed to compete.
Right.
And so Gunnar and I showed up there thinking, and I think rightly so, after, you know, everybody kind of lumps us into that whole hairband era. But we were playing clubs 10 years earlier when it was punk and rockabilly and new wave in the LA clubs.
Which is what I heard a little bit of in the car. That's
right.
What
well,
I was
the
saying.
Influence is definitely
there. Still there.
It's still there. And, you know, Matt and I started playing the LA clubs professionally when we were 12. We started really, really young. And so we were doing the club thing in LA, which was a very vibrant scene, as he mentioned, during the whole skinny tie band era.
Right.
It seemed like every band had a "the" in front of their name. So we were sharing the stage with like the Knack and the Bengals and the Go-Go's and X and, you know, all these wow. really cool bands.
Wow.
But we were kids. You know, there's a law now in LA that where an underage performer can go in and perform as long as they're with an adult and they're escorted out immediately after. That's our law.
Really?
Yeah, that's our law. We actually went down with Michelle, who was the booker at Madame Wong's West, because we wanted to play the club. And at that time, you couldn't. And we thought that was unfair. So did she. So we went down to City Hall and we petitioned City Hall and we got that whole thing passed. So,
you know, you find a way.
Wow.
You know?
No, yeah.
You just find a way. And that's, I guess, what it was with Gunnar and I, you know, was you find a way. Yeah. And so coming up young like that.
And the reality is like when we were coming up doing that, our dad was our best friend, but he was gone all the time, man. You right. know, he was on the road and he had a very expensive wife, which ended up in an even more expensive divorce. But he was trying to keep it going, and she was spending more than he could make. But it made him have to be gone all the time.
Right.
And our mom was pretty awful. So what we had was our music and each other. That's what kept us sane. So for like a lot of people, music really saved us. It really did. And so
recently I just said that if we had had the life that a lot of people that dismissed us thought we had, we never would have achieved anything. If it was as easy as they thought it was, nothing would have happened for us.
It's like that whole butterfly effect. You change one thing, nothing would turn out.
Exactly. Well, the music business is not an easy business to be in. But then when you're being held down, like you guys were, you were having to fight through all these unnecessary things that were being put on top of
you. Well, it's kind of like that whole guilty until proven innocent thing. Right. But we were used to being around that because our dad had a real run of that whole thing, if you think about it. Actually, going back even further, Grandpa Ozzie, no one knew that he graduated with a law degree from Rutgers. Dude was brilliant.
I didn't know that.
He was like, still holds the record as the youngest Eagle Scout in history at 12. I mean, just an amazing man. I mean,
he wrote, produced, edited, directed, and starred in all 435 episodes of the show. He was an overachiever guy. Wow. Ran a big band successfully.
On something that he didn't even know anything about.
Right.
You know, like the TV business was...
Grandpa Ozzie couldn't write or read a note of music.
Wow.
But it never stopped him from running a big band.
Right.
You know, he was just smart enough to hire people who could.
Right.
Right. So it doesn't matter if you're limited, if you're watching the show and you're limited in some way, don't let it stop you. You know, it has nothing to
figure it out. Yeah.
And then, you know, along comes our father, and it was a blessing and a curse. He had the television show. No one was singing on TV at the time. The popular belief was free milk and a cow of the industry. If you sing music for free on TV, then the kids aren't going to go down to the record stores and buy the record. So no one did it. And our dad kind of started that on that weekly thing. And then all of a sudden, America's tuning in to watch him sing at the end
of the
show.
The first music videos.
Pretty much. And so, you know, but he was so beautiful. He was such a good looking man.
Look at you guys, though.
No, I wish I had a picture of my pop.
I know. I wish I had one in here, too. I'm going to after this. Yeah. I got to have some Rick Nelson.
He was just so good looking. And he was on the television show. So... And also kind of guilt by association, not by his doing, but later on there were all the Fabians and all the made-for-TV people who weren't really real.
Right.
They were just a pretty face that were meant to be in the teen magazines, and it was a marketing thing. Our dad, actually, in hindsight, if you look at it, he was performing up to 300 shows a year up until the day he died. And he could have gone down the road of being a fine film actor. He was in Rio Bravo with John Wayne, did an amazing job at that.
Oh,
and
that movie?
Yeah. And it's arguably a much easier life if you think about it. That's a life of fixed schedules and personal assistants and deli trays.
He actually got a Golden Globe for that.
But as a lifestyle, it's a lot easier, arguably, to do TV or to do just film. Being on the road is hard, man. And he chose... to do music. So it turned out that Ricky Nelson was a rocker that happened to be a talented actor, not the other way around.
Wow.
But he was always treated as guilty until proven innocent because he had this beautiful face and all that kind of stuff. But I mean, example, he was inducted the second year into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, not the first. And he should have been. I found out in hindsight that the Elvis Presley estate had something to do with that. But, you know, we'll talk about that later.
Wow.
A little friendly rivalry. But
yeah.
You know, our dad had a soft approach. The Nelson family's always had a really soft approach. You know, being gauche is not what we do. You know, we are the anti-Kardashians. We've always been that way. You know, it was never in our grandparents' era, of course, airing your dirty laundry in public was just not what you did. You were supposed to be inspiring, and you were supposed to be a celebrity for doing something extraordinary. You know, not for just existing.
Right.
And the times, of course, they've changed quite a bit. arguably not for the better, but they are what they are, which is cool. Just our family has really put their heads down and done the work. It's all about doing the work. Mm-hmm. You know, they never, Grandpa Ozzie, think about this. Longest running sitcom in history, like we mentioned.
Right.
Pioneering the camera techniques, doing all that. Not a single Emmy. Why is that? Not a single Emmy.
Wow.
Ricky Nelson sold 500 million singles. 500 million. There were only two artists in the 50s that had number one rock records. Only two. Elvis and Ricky. Not a single Grammy. Why is that? You know, you just gotta, yeah. You gotta think about that, because they were not about going to the parties.
And then Gunnar and I, where do I start? You know,
yeah, like, I know, saying, huh?
No, but no, it's kind of like this. You know, I honestly believe, and we're kind of talking all about this, is that all these people figured it out and kept moving forward. It's about not quitting. That has a lot to do with mm-hmm. it. Mm-hmm. You know, it's easy to quit. And yeah, this business sucks. It really does. But on the other side of it, you're connecting with people that not only inspire you as an artist, but hopefully you do something that inspires them. I mean, we've kind of distilled it down to three rules.
Our three rules, right. The first one, be undeniably good.
Yeah.
And that can mean a lot of things. Be undeniably good. Second, keep your sense of humor, because you're going to need it. Huh. Mm-hmm. And third, don't be a dick. just three. That's it. That's all you have to remember.
You know, there are fans in the next room. Okay. And if you're there, we're waving hi to you.
Hi.
they're in the next room because of you guys. And one of them was in the car, and she had her grandbabies. She wanted to come so bad. I said, go ahead, bring them.
Bring them, sure.
Bring them along. And you're out there helping her get the babies out of the car.
It's hot here, man.
That is the kind of guys that you are. It goes back
as opposed to what?
Exactly. But you guys are, I mean, come on, man.
Well, this
you guys
do.
Are rock stars.
Nah.
But hey, no, and I know that. But out there, these are good guys. And that's first and foremost that you're good humans. And
bless you, man. Thank you for saying that. There's something that I wanted to touch on with you, Rick, because I've got to ask you a question.
Sure.
Bryan, why do you do this?
I do this because I love lifting people up. I love having someone sitting in that chair and sharing their inspiring stories. I want them out there to be moved and inspired, so that the little Aussie who's sitting at home, you know, looking at his idol or whoever it is, says, I can do that too.
Okay.
Whatever it is. Okay. That's it.
So you want to make a difference and you want to improve things. Why do you do what you do?
Same exact thing.
Okay. Every now and again we get asked, you know, I want to break into this business, not even entertainment, whatever. How do I do this? My advice and the most valuable advice I ever got is that you've really got to identify first, before you even leave the house or think about doing something, what your reason why is. And you got to really focus on that. Why are you doing what you're doing? Because then it becomes a quest.
Right.
Then it's not something you should do. It's something that you have to do. And the reason why you have to do that is because it's going to be a bitch to do it. There are going to be moments when you don't think you can get any lower. There are going to be moments when everyone's forgotten about you. They've counted you completely over and out. You're broke. You're homeless. You're divorced. Whatever it is. And your reason why is going to be the only thing that you've got, you know, keeping you breathing and moving forward. And
that was inspiring.
Well, I mean, it's really, to me, it's important. And it was kind of fortified by, sitting there wasting time like a lot of us do watching a TikTok the other day. And there was something that just hit me in the right way. There was one of those forums where a guy was doing his podcast, and he's sitting there talking to women. It's kind of like this whole battle of the sexes thing and stuff. And they're interviewing each other, and he's talking to a woman who says, well, I'm not going to have kids. I'm just going to focus on my career, and kids are distracting. I'm not going to do it. And the guy says, well, I'm going to give you some contrast. Last week, I went to my grandmother's 93rd birthday, and in that room were 70 people that she had a hand in creating.
Wow.
Down to great grandchildren. There were 70 people that came from this beautiful woman who made a different choice in her life. Now, let me ask you something. When you're sitting there at 55 and you've not had kids and you're past being able to have kids and you've got a little extra money to buy an extra purse, do you think that's going to make you happy? And it dawned over this poor woman that she had been misguided at that point. And I could see that kind of thunderclap happen. And that was her reason why really, he was really kind of needling that, going, well, great, you have a career,
but then what?
But why?
You know,
and we've had those moments. I think all of us have
moments, and I see it now. You mentioned my son. He's 8 years old, and right. You know, he spends a lot of time on the phone playing games or whatever. He's a digital kid, you know.
Right.
We're a new generation. We're analog kids. Yeah. I mean, I remember Gunnar and I were, you know, the first with a cell phone that was that big and stuff like that, and things have moved on. But we're also in a really dangerous position. Obviously, we've been living in Jumanji for a couple of years, and that's you know, we need 3 weeks to talk about all that stuff.
Right.
But if you notice that everybody's got a phone and they're all, look at me, look at me, look at me, 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 me. It's all about me. That's where you get into trouble, because that's a lie.
Right.
You know, you're talking about being inspiring for people and inspiring yourself, but you can't do this alone. Whether it's God, whether it's your friends, all that kind of stuff, you have to have that reason why, and it's got to be bigger than I want that purse. It's got to be bigger than I just want to be famous. You ask a lot of kids now, they go, I want to be a YouTuber. Well, okay, why?
But why?
But why do you want to?
Because I want to make a lot of money.
But why?
But why?
Right.
You know, go deeper. And a lot of people, that's what's really scary. They don't go deeper than that.
Well, it's scary, you know, to go deep, man. When it comes down to it,
you got to be honest with yourself.
Well, you got to be brave enough to be vulnerable. You know, we don't have all the answers,
right,
of course. And you do need help, like you said, whether it's from God or your friends or your family or whatever, to support you in that. My best example is that I got a phone call when I was 22. I'm sitting there getting my fabulous hair done.
And it was fabulous.
And my manager, Larry, called me. And he said, you sitting down? I said, I happen to be in foils right here, right now. And he said, okay, well, I just wanted to be the first person to tell you that tomorrow, on your birthday, on your 22nd birthday, you are now the number one act on planet Earth. Love and Affection will be the number one song on the Hot 100 tomorrow.
Wow.
And I got that phone call, and it was not what I expected. I sat there and I got the news, and I was terrified, because I thought that achieving that was going to make me happy, that I was going to feel this peace, and I was going to feel this completion happen, and all that emptiness that I'd felt up to that point, because I was coming, I'm gonna be straight up honest, up until that point, I was really coming from ego. I wanted to prove all those teachers wrong, those well-meaning friends that said, why even do this? You're never gonna be as successful as your dad. Why even bother? I wanted to prove them wrong. And I'd realized that I'd wasted all of my time trying to achieve. I didn't even remember the journey. We'd worked so hard going to radio station, because I was coming from the wrong place. I was coming from, I am really worthy. I am really badass. I'm really famous. I'm really whatever. And it was so empty, man.
So, Gunnar, let me ask you a question.
Huh?
Looking back on this all these years later,
mm-hmm.
What were the moments in that 2-year snippet of your life, what were the moments you really remember?
Dude, I can't talk about it without messing up. There was a little girl, named Erin Vallely. And Erin Vallely was 13 years old, and she was a beautiful little girl. I was introduced to Erin through my girlfriend at the time, Laurel. Her family was friends with Erin's friends. Erin was fighting cancer, and she was the poster child, literally, for Orange County Children's Hospital. And she was a big fan. And, I mean, just big blue eyes and gorgeous and beautiful and with the wig and the whole thing going through her treatment. And I met her when we were on our first round. She was brought down to that same video that you saw.
Okay.
And met her and got close to her and stuff. And
wasn't she sweet? She was just a ball of light.
Just the neatest kid. Really, just such a neat kid. God, it's really hard.
Yeah,
So I'll take over. So Erin, you go. That was at the beginning of the thing. We hadn't been on tour yet, and we always kind of stayed in touch with her or whatever, but she started going into pretty serious treatment for her cancer, and she couldn't go to the shows because you can't be around a lot of people. You know, it's very real when you're going through chemotherapy. So I remember we were coming back around, and I think it was our second leg of the tour, like the final leg of the tour, and we got news that Erin was going to be coming to our show in Orange County. I think it was called the Pacific Amphitheater or something.
I got it from here, yeah, the Pacific Amphitheater. And I was really excited when I heard about it, because I thought, oh, she's finally better. And they said, no, you don't understand. she's turned a corner and she's not going to get any better. So they're going to let her go, right? They're not as concerned about, you know, her recovery at this point. So the moment for me was being at the front of that stage and singing our ballad, Only Time Will Tell. I didn't see the 20,000 people that were there. I was holding her hand and singing to her. She was in the front row. And
you actually picked her up. I remember you carried her.
It was easy to do, unfortunately, at that time. That was, to me, when things changed for me. And later on that night, it was amazing. We pulled the tour bus. It was called Hotel California. We got it from the Eagles, and it was all painted. It was beautiful.
Wow.
And we paid a visit to the Orange County Children's Home that night. It was about midnight. And they made an exception for us to go in because it was way after visiting hours and stuff.
And I remember it was interesting, too, because all the kids that were going through cancer treatment were in kind of like a dorm together, like a communal dorm, so they could support each other and stuff. But these are kids 5 years old, you know, up to, I think, 16.
Yeah.
You know?
And the whole band went in there and visited with the kids for a few hours and sang for them and hugged them and talked to them and did all that stuff. And we went back to the bus. And our drummer, Bobby Rock, who you see in the videos, I mean, big old...
He's an amazing guy.
Amazing guy.
I know Bobby.
But a big old muscle-bound guy, yeah. And very stoic as a guy. And we were all sitting on the bus, and it was one of those things where we all got on the bus after that visit, and it was silent for like a straight minute. No one said a word. And then you hear Bobby start to cry. And the whole bus went down. Like,
sorry, buddy.
No, but this is why we're doing it.
Yeah.
This is the reason why. It's not about, you know, money or fame or stats or, you know.
Sorry.
No, it's okay. You know, that's why, you know, that's what this is about. And I think the thing that I can look back on, and I have the same, obviously, Gunnar and I are twins, but, you know, that's the real aspect of what we're doing. And and that's the thing that I remember why I'm saying that it's important to connect with your reason to do it, because... Like anything, you know, that you go through seasons. And Gunnar and I went through a thing where we were the top band in the world, and then it just ended overnight. And that wasn't organic. That was engineered by the business, the evil business.
That.
And I remember going to visit some kids at the hospital, you know, about 6 months kind of after the whole grunge thing happened. And these kids had kind of moved on. And I remember it really, that was the thing that I missed the most, was the fact that I felt like we could do something and take those people to a different place when they were going through agony and stuff like that. And that's why you help people in from the car. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, it's
this every single day.
Yeah.
Every day.
No, every day.
Every day I remember Erin Vallely and I see her eyes and I go, that's why I'm getting out of bed. That's why I'm reading a bad review and laughing at it.
Right.
That's why I'm doing another take at 4:30 in the morning. That's why I care about the way the kick drum sounds. That's why I'm doing it, is because of that. You know, already been famous, already been rich, already bucked the odds, already proved people wrong.
Right. We've nearly died, both of us, numerous times doing what we
do.
Yep. We keep going because of that.
Yeah.
It's the same thing. It's amazing. You know, obviously we're twins, but you have an experience like that, and that was always there. But what a concrete example of why you don't quit. Because somewhere out there, if you're lucky, there's somebody that you mean something to, whether it's in your family or your friends or whatever. You know, you got to be present to win, even when you don't feel like it. And, you know, and I think it's because also you're a pro ball player. You know, you understand that as well, is you show up and you play hurt. And you, because it's not that moment. It's what that leads to. And,
you know, you think that if there's one person in the audience that is going to get that from you, then you sing sick.
Right.
And you play sick and you show up and you do what you do. And in our case, we got to be at death's door for real, like unable to get out of bed. And I've only had to cancel a show one time because I physically didn't have an instrument anymore.
Well, it was what was funny is the show leading to that moment you're talking about, we actually had a show booked.
Wow, that's a lot of shows to have. Only one right now. That's
well, crazy. What happened was we were going to be playing in Manhattan on our first tour, and it was the Radio City Music Hall, big place, you know, some place you really want to play. The night before, we were at a place called the Syria Mosque, which is not there anymore, and that was in, was that Philly or Pittsburgh? It was Pittsburgh, I think.
Pittsburgh.
And Gunnar was having a tough time with a throat infection, And we're a singing band. There were no tracks or anything like that, as I mentioned.
Yeah.
It's funny, we always used to get reviews. Oh, they were running tracks. No, we weren't. That's when it was like taboo. Remember the Milli Vanilli thing?
Oh, yeah.
Paula Abdul. And so we get in there, and Gunnar says, guys, I'm going to try to sing a little softer, so try to back me a little bit on there. And we get out there, and Gunnar goes into the first song. On the first chorus, he looks at me, and he's got this terror in his eyes. Now, I'm telling that there were 10,000 people in there going completely berserk. And on the first song, he loses it. There's not.
I mean, we're talking air. There's nothing coming out.
Right.
There's nothing. You've been there.
Yeah, I've been there.
I mean, it's like people ask me, what's that like getting on stage? It's like, you know what? It's going into a gunfight with a squirt gun.
It's the naked actor dream.
Not good. You know?
It's the naked actor dream. And he looks at me. Now, here's the cool thing about being twins and stuff. Like, he looks at me, and I looked at him and went,
I got it.
And he lip-synced.
I lip-synced.
I sang his parts the whole show.
And the whole band shifted. Just by looking at each other, everybody shifted their parts.
You know, so Paul sang Matt's part, all this kind of, like, we had that kind of
band. Now, here's the problem. Last week, a girl came up to us in an autograph line and said, I saw you at the Syria Mosque. It was the best show you guys ever did.
Maddie was singing for me.
That's funny.
That's amazing. You surrounded yourselves with great players. You just mentioned, too, I want to say thank you for sharing that.
Oh, brother.
Story.
Look, I didn't want to get too heavy, man. No. I really didn't. And the punchline of that whole thing, we'll get off of that whole thing. If you warp forward a couple of months at that time, Erin was fighting her final fight. And the doctors couldn't figure out why she had lasted as long as she had. You know, even her mom was saying, like, honey, we love you and it's going to be okay. We'll see you in heaven. You can let go. And she would just smile and nod her head and all that kind of
shit. She's like, I'm waiting for something. I'm waiting for something.
And then the night before her birthday, her mom said, you know, it's Matthew and Gunnar's birthday tomorrow. And she smiled. She said, I know. And she said, I'm waiting to die on their birthday, so they'll never forget me. And she did. So.
Whoa.
Heavy, yeah. So she's still out there and all that stuff. But
thanks, Gunnar.
Well, no.
I know, dude, you got me. Like, I'm over here crying.
No, brother, look, I never get a chance to talk about this. And I can only talk this way because we're family.
We're friends.
I would never talk about this just going out and doing another show. I wouldn't. But we're family, so I feel safe here.
Exactly.
But, you know, people think, you never know what kind of day you're walking in on somebody on. Mm-hmm. And the danger in just basically dismissing anybody just from what you see on the TV or what they've spun or whatever like that, making a judgment's never a good thing. And I have a hard time with that. You know, I tend to struggle. I struggle with forgiveness and I struggle with judgment and I work on it all the time. You know, it's really kind of my thing growing up with the parenting that we had. You know, you had to be tough.
Right.
And in my case, you know, you had to harden yourself up a lot.
You guys went through a lot.
But it took a 13-year-old girl going through her struggle to kind of, you know, melt the ice cube, so to speak. And that's when my journey shifted from being a journey of ego to being a journey of purpose. And I've never felt more successful than I did after I had my success. Does that make any sense to you?
No, it does.
Yeah.
It does, because I say that we also... When asked, what do you want to do with this? And I'm like, success for me is being able to continue to do it. And you guys are here in Las Vegas performing right now at the South Point. You had a great show last night. You're playing tonight and tomorrow. This is like a second home to you. And I know Las Vegas is like a hit and run, but there's something special. It's three nights in a big room.
And all I was looking forward to was... I'm glad to play, but I was looking forward to this.
Oh, man.
You know? So,
Thank you. So
that's, and again, because we have moments like this. This is the real stuff. And Gunnar and I have to say the one karma that our family has had has been, I think that we are just, I can look at it from above. We are really misunderstood. And I think, and I get it, because.
I would misunderstand you.
I absolutely would.
Did you see our outfits?
Yeah, but
holy crap,
dude, that was the thing. And but here was you guys.
But we did that on purpose because
you did.
There were no guarantees that people were going to pay attention to us at all. So
our thinking was you're zipping through. Well, MTV was the biggest radio station in the world at the time. You're zipping through the channels and you've got like a second and a half to capture people's attention just to where they're parking enough to hear the music.
You guys were the host for like 5 days in a row.
That's
I remember that. I turned on, I'm like, who are these guys?
Yeah, who are these girls?
Exactly.
That's right. And that's what broke it, though. It wasn't the label. We never got the nod from the label. It was kind of like, you know, our fans had a chance to vote for our video that blew it up, much to the label's chagrin. Yeah. I mean, I'm not saying that they were unhappy that they were making a lot of money. It's just that they had pegged other bands to get all of the funding. I mean, Nelson never got a penny of tour support.
Right.
Our t-shirt sales funded it. You know, it was all fan-driven, which was cool. It's what made it even better for us.
I mean, you would think that you're having all that success with the band as a record company and stuff like that, but you have to see that Matthew and I were like the anti-establishment and the anti-agenda at the time. I mean, John Kalodner looked at us as the heavy metal Hollies. We weren't supposed to be a hair band.
Right.
You know, we grew up in Southern California. We grew up with, you know, our dad's Stone Canyon Band and Jackson Browne and Joni Mitchell and Crosby, Stills, and Nash, and Linda Ronstadt. And,
oh, Linda.
You know,
love
her. But that Southern California thing, the one thing that all of that had in common, none of it came from the blues. It wasn't 1-4-5 blues oriented. It was more folk and country. That's what that thing was.
Right.
Guns N' Roses, by contrast, and what was hot at the time, blues oriented.
Right.
And don't get me wrong, I love blues oriented rock. I really do. But I promise you, it's far easier as a creator to sound tough if you throw in 1-4-5 blues changes.
Right.
You know, it just is, you know, to sound big and like you were listening to the greatest hits. I'm sure there are a couple of songs in there that you'd never heard before.
Oh, yeah.
You know, there's one in particular that we chose to end the album with. It's called Take Me There, which honestly, with my experience with Nelson, production-wise, writing-wise, and message-wise, to me, that's what I'm most proud of for Nelson. I'm more proud of that song than of Love and Affection and After the Rain and More Than Ever and Only Time Will Tell, because it really does. The song being Take Me There is really taking you to a higher existence, a higher motivation,
right,
so to speak. Your podcast is about the hero's journey. Mm-hmm. If there's anything that I learned in that long career, is it's really about heart. It's not about the head. It's about what I feel God put us all on the planet to do. We are each here for a reason. None of us are here by accident. You're not here by accident. There's something that we're all meant to tap into and to midwife. And I personally believe, even in living in Jumanji, what a horrible time this has been. This has been awful. It's been all about the head and ego and you know,
fear,
and
a lot of fear,
tons of fear. And no one's got a sense of humor anymore. And people are, I mean, you know, right is left and left is right and all this stuff. And you feel like you're going crazy.
Right.
The only thing that's going to keep you grounded and centered through all of that is your reason why and your connection. You know, Grandma Harriet had a great quote. She said, you know, boys, if you're going to do this, keep this in mind. The secret to the Nelson family success, we've never been in music, really. We've never been in television and film. We've been in the connection business.
That's amazing.
That's what we do. So always keep that in mind. And that's kind of what I wanted to tell you coming into this is like, Bryan, you're in the connection business.
Yeah.
How you connect with people is irrelevant.
Whether it's music or this,
yeah,
it's the same goal.
Right.
It's the same goal.
Right.
And it's really not an ego-driven thing when it's really working. You know?
Right.
It's bigger than us. You know, one thing I got to say that we're very fortunate too as well is, yes, our dad was our best friend, kind of going all the way back to what you were saying.
Right.
And we miss him a lot. He was only 45 when we lost him. And we were supposed to be with him when his plane went down. And for some reason, he changed his mind, said, stay home. And we did. And we're here now. And even looking at that tragedy that happened, and I miss him every day.
Right.
The fact is that if that hadn't happened, I know this is weird to say, but we just wouldn't be where we are right now. Because God has a plan. And every little change that goes through, you might think it's, and it was excruciating. It was a trial by fire, what we went through, just even in that moment. You know, I have to call that like a football game because I will just start crying.
Right.
But that's why After the Rain, the song After the Rain, happened. That's why the album happened. You have to go through these things.
And you know, the domino effect of that, you don't know who you're going to affect, right?
Right.
I can't tell you the amount of people that we've met throughout the years we've been blessed with who said, you know, I mean, some specific examples. I was going to end it. One particular kid said, I was sitting there, I had my dad's loaded gun on my lap, and I'd given away all of my stuff to all of my friends at school that day, and that was gonna be the day. Kid's 15 years old at the time.
They don't know even what they're doing at 15.
Not at all. They don't know how permanent death can be.
Right.
You know, and he said, I was sitting there, And everyone was out of the house, and I had MTV on in the background. And your After the Rain video came on. It had this whole vignette before of a father and a son fighting with each other, and the kid escaping into his music, and then waking up after the video and all that stuff. It's kind of artsy and stuff. And he said, and I saw that, and something just made me call the suicide hotline number. And now I've got kids, and I've got, you know, beautiful family and a wonderful life, and I just wanted to say thank you. And in moments like that, you just go,
chills.
Oh no, for real. But the story behind that whole thing is when we first submitted that video to MTV, even though we'd had a number one video with Love and Affection before that, I called my manager and I said, so what did they think about it? Because that came to us in a dream.
Yeah, we were really proud of that video.
Right. Really proud of that video. And paid our own money to do all the post effects and all that kind of stuff because we believed in it so much. And he said, you're not going to believe this, but they shot it down. They're not going to air it.
His quote was, they laughed at it.
They laughed at it. I said, laughed at it? What are you talking about? He goes, well, they'll only play it if all the spiritual stuff between the father and the son and all that, so you've got to edit that out. They want to go straight to the performance. And I said, absolutely not. And he said, no, you're not understanding. They're not going to play the video. Said, screw them. Not going to happen. Not going to do it. I'm not going to change that. That's the whole point to the whole thing. Mm-hmm. And I said, how's this? Go back to them with the deal. Tell them to spin that video once at 3 a.m. and see what the request lines do. And so that's what happened. For 3 weeks, that video, you could only see that video in the middle of the night. They played it one time. Number one most requested video for 3 weeks straight.
Wow.
And then we had to make a long story short, pull some political strings. We finally had to go to the head of our label and say, you need to intervene because this is ridiculous. Somebody.
It's personal.
There was a guy there who just, you know, a lot of guys hated us, whatever. So there was one key guy, the decision maker at MTV, who just wanted to show us a thing or two about the real world. And anyways, he got overridden. And if that whole thing hadn't happened, if we hadn't held to our guns about what we believed was the right thing to do at this level and keep that video exactly as it was, who knows? Maybe I wouldn't have had that conversation with that fan years later.
Exactly.
You never know when your Wednesday is going to be the moment that changes someone else's life.
Right.
So use that responsibly. Don't be a puss. Don't give up. You know, if you know it's the right thing to do, freaking do it.
That's inspiring. That's amazing. Before wrapping this up, I just want to...
we're wrapping up already? Dude, we're just getting started.
Dude,
I'm going to say this is part one of a many-part series.
Yeah, we got to do this, okay? But what I want you guys to do is, really quickly, you have a new album that just dropped again. So if you're out there listening and watching... It's the greatest hits and near misses.
Nelson, that's right. Greatest hits and near misses. It's funny after going through all that. Now we're pitching like Sandy Koufax. Yeah, but it's a good thing, and it's a, you know, it was nice to be in the mastering studio with my brother here and going through finally a full collection.
30 years of music,
because we did a deal with our old label. It wound up being Universal, and you know, Gunnar and I were carrying a lot of like old record company debt and stuff like that, and we basically said, hey, you know what? Let's go in the garage and do karate together. Let's join forces.
Yeah.
And so we did that. We kind of cleared the decks and put this thing together. And we're so proud of it because for the first time, people don't only get the first two albums, they get all of it. And if you ever wanted it, our whole goal was hand it to somebody and say, this is Nelson.
Correct. Okay. Yeah, we wanted it to be a snapshot. Like, if you want to know what this band is start to finish, here you go.
It's amazing.
You know, Ted Jensen mastered it, which was great. It sounds wonderful.
It sounds incredible. It sounds new, up to date. It's like right now. And it tells your story. But then there you have a new story, the Firstborn Sons.
Firstborn Sons, yeah. This is my cease and desist shirt.
There you go.
That's right. He's going to be getting a letter from General Motors tomorrow.
Right, exactly.
Yeah.
So that's something that's coming soon. And then the show you do right now is the Ricky Nelson Remembered Show.
It's something that we've done. We actually decided to do this, obviously out of choice. It's not a show we would have done had we not made our own mark first. But throughout all the years, we had certain people coming up going, hey, man, when can we hear some of your dad's music? And we realized that they missed him too. So we thought it merited its own show. So that's what we did. We put together a retrospective on our father. We like to call it it's a celebration, not a tribute. We're not up there in Ricky suits trying to be Ricky. But we do approach the music with seriousness, but not ourselves. And it's a great night. It's kind of like an Annie biography meets a rock and roll concert.
It's incredible. Some of the things that your father has said, I've seen in videos from seeing the show multiple times, have inspired me. And I never met him. It's almost like having a mentor that I've never met because of the stories that I've heard you guys talk about sharing with me, and then on stage sharing with an audience. Things like how music kept him young.
Sure.
That's what it does to me.
Well, in a very real sense, you know, what's wonderful about being a musician, and hopefully if you catch a lick and people make you a part of their lives, you kind of live forever. There's a great Scandinavian proverb, every man dies two deaths. The first one is when his physical body goes, and the second and final one is when the last person who loves them goes. Wow. And so in that sense, he's very much around.
Yeah.
And selfishly speaking, it's so nice when I'm feeling a little blue or feeling disconnected. It's been a lot of years, man, you know, since that's still present in your mind. When you've lost somebody, of course, I mean, it still feels immediate and stuff. Yeah. But when I'm starting to feel disconnected, you know, I get into a grocery store or something and Garden Party will come on. And I'm like, yeah. Oh, hey, Pop.
Yeah, yeah. He's here. Yeah. He's talking to me.
You know how cool it is having an 8-year-old and being able to play him music and say, this is your Grandpa Rick.
Right.
And go through all that, you know, and he's already he's so digging music. It's in the blood. It just is there.
He's playing it in the background every time I call you. Doing something.
Doing something.
I hate that I have to wrap this up. We have an hour here, but this was.
Well, then be like a cowboy. Be like a cowboy. Don't say goodbye. Cowboys never say goodbye.
Okay.
See you later.
We're not. Yeah. Yeah, it's, we're not saying goodbye. Mm-hmm. What I want to say is we're going to continue this because. Okay. There are so many more stories.
Oh, yeah.
The things that you guys grew up with, Uncle George and, you know, who, that's the Beatles. And just all the stories, the Eagles, you know. You guys have so many more stories that I want to share later on. So the next time you pass through, we got to do this again.
Done.
We definitely have to. Yeah. As a matter of fact, Gunnar and I, we're working on a book finally.
Actually, we're working on two
of them.
One, believe it or not, I don't know what happened. Matthew and I woke up and we were classic rock all of a sudden.
We're going to wind up doing Matthew and Gunnar Remembered.
That's amazing.
But we've been approached by a wonderful writer named Chris Epting, and he's written some great musical biographies and stuff, and we're going to get a chance finally to tell our story, you know, about playing the clubs and doing the whole thing.
And the stuff kind of we've touched on today. There's so many of these stories.
And it also looks like we're about to refresh. There was an unauthorized biography that was written on our father the year he passed. And we've never done, as a family and as the Rick Nelson Company, an authorized biography, but we're going to take that book and we're going to refresh it and update it and make it the authorized biography and release it too. So that's going to be kind of nice.
Congratulations. Well. That's amazing. Well, here's the thing. I love you both.
Love you too.
Love
brother.
You back, man.
Very, very much. And sitting here, you brought me to tears.
Dude, I am sorry. I just cried all over your show.
I'm inspired. I'm moved. And thank you for being a part of this. So I got Matt Nelson. Gunnar Nelson to me, right in front of me. I love you guys. Thank you so much. My name is Bryan Hopkins. This is a Hero's Journey podcast. And today I had the chief nerd running the show. Thank you so much, Travis.
No problem. Thank you.
All right, buddy. So tell your friends, if you get the chance, go download the new Nelson album. Go download it. Buy it. But it's on iTunes, Spotify, everywhere you get your music. Go get it. I love you guys.
You too, brother.
We will see you soon. Hopefully this touched and inspired someone out there, and you go after that line, cross that line into an adventure. All right, we'll talk to you soon.
Dream, and I believe it's coming around to me.